BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency. Funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.
Good evening and welcome to Poets Pause. I am starting to say Burke's Bards. I apologize. My name is Marilyn Klimcho. I'll be your host for this evening. And I want to share with you that Burke's Bards is doing first Thursday of the month at 6 p.m. And that's going to be on Zoom. My poet tonight sent me these lines as an inspiration, and I thought they were wonderful. They're by Jeffrey McDaniel, and it's titled The Foxhole Manifesto, and these are a few selected lines from that poem. I knew if there was a God, he could see through us, like we were made out of cellophane, like he could stare directly into our hearts the way we look into an aquarium. Like he'd know what was floating around in there, like he might be feeding one. Yeah, he might be the one feeding it. I apologize, I read that badly. Like he might be the one feeding it. So my poet this evening is Rebecca O Bern. She's had poems published in Barely South Review, the Connecticut Review, South 85 Journal, Storm Cellar, Buddhist Poetry Review, and Heartskill Review, and other journals as well. She has new work forthcoming in Notre Dame Review, and she's the recipient of the Leslie Leeds Poetry Prize. She serves as co-editor-in-chief of the online international literary journal Mud Season Review, and writes a lot of poems that explore interconnected themes of self, family, and religion. She was a graduate of Southern Connecticut State University, where she got an MFA, and she's taught in the English department there. So welcome to the poem, Rebecca O Bern. Hi, how are you?
Hi, Marilyn. Well, thanks for having me on.
Oh, I'm so glad to see you. And I have to tell my audience that I was blown away by a poem that I found that you had written called Theratodes. And I don't know when you would like to reveal that poem during the reading, but I'm hoping that it's included as one of your selections.
Oh, thank you. I was actually planning on reading that one first, actually, coincidentally.
Well, that is wonderful. So please go ahead. I'd love to hear your work. I'd love to share it.
Sure. So I'm not 100% sure about the pronunciation of the title, but I've been going with Theratodes. Theratodes, moth of the Tibetan plateau. Long before I was born, my father was a boy with a pet squirrel. It stayed in his pocket as he fed it snacks throughout the school day. His teacher found out, let the squirrel go. At 85, the Dalai Lama's doctors say he'll live to 100. Good thing. Plenty more time to study life's intricate relationships between science and religion. My father, too, fills his years with books and Bibles. Now at 80, his doctor doesn't say how long, just that the pacemaker should help. He drinks tea daily. As a boy, the Dalai Lama held out his hand to catch a Theratodes. He watched its wings beat for hours, witnessed shapes and patterns like that of a butterfly, and felt forever changed. 14 reincarnated lifetimes are enough, says the Dalai Lama, if that's what is best. My father doesn't shave his beard anymore, has to take his time coming down the stairs. The four bright golden wings of Theratodes oppose each other's symmetry in sets of two, yet attach themselves to the same body. This is the way of things. I drink tea too.
I love that ending, that you bring it back to, I drink tea too. I was just blown away with that. In fact, I'm making several attempts to kind of write my own poem in that sort of style, you know, as an inspiration. Talk, if you would, talk about what generated this poem for you.
Sure. So it is, the poem is based on, the speaker in the poem is based on my life. So my father turned 80 earlier this year. And I've noticed over the years, a lot of my poems drifting toward themes of aging, particularly with my dad and my mom. So I guess I'm exploring that in my art, that experience of parents getting older. So with this poem, I was initially inspired by, it was just a few connections metaphorically that I made between several different, it wasn't just a metaphor between two, it was somehow the Dalai Lama, but also the moth, but also my father. And as I was exploring the poem, eventually I realized that I belonged in the poem, and then I was able to finish writing it.
Well, and I find that's true too. If I want inspiration, I keep a whole bank of passing ideas that have crossed my mind. Like I'll write them briefly down on notes, and then I'll put them into different folders on my computer, type them in. And if I really want to write a good story or a good poem, I'll pull 3-4 what seem like very disparate items together, and then I find I have a poem. Do you have more like that? That where you've pulled in some items that just seem so different from each other?
This poem is a bit different, I guess, than others I've written. A lot of times I'll braid maybe two mm-hmm. ideas or three, but this one does seem to have more, I think, than I usually do, with the tea and all the different layers.
I'm glad I asked you, because I wasn't sure how you were, if you were consistently doing that or just, this is that, and we get that lift. It's a beautiful poem. But anyway, go on, read what you have selected.
Sure. You want me to read my next poem?
Yeah, sure. Whatever you've got.
Sure. So this next poem is called Mother. And I have a longer epigraph. It's for Emily Dickinson, who lost her mother to a stroke and who meticulously cataloged her garden in a notebook. They say tending an herbarium is the toughest work a daughter will ever do, that its pages of green, vibrant plants can turn black and curl in the corners at any moment, because life can't be weighed, cataloged, and slipped into a notebook of stems and seeds as if a thing that can be held. That a daughter has to wake up one of these days and touch the dirt by the headstone with her bare hands, pressed down so deep that she carries the earth with her now like a new fingerprint. A reminder that not all flowers are perennials, that tending anything alive makes fingers bruise, swell, wrists ache.
That's a beautiful poem. Keep going.
Would you like me to read another piece?
Yes, please.
Sure. This next poem, it's related to the previous poem called Mother. It's in a theme of poems I've been writing in this area. This next piece is called There, There. Make amends with all lilies at the cemetery, Father Kevin tells me. I know your mother still recedes into the soil and will for a while. New life will sprout of bone. Yet these flowers of memory wilt daily. How to befriend petals of lost time. Even the thought is laughable, and so I laugh, crush a bloom. Try to lift my spirit as it falls to earth. Just as I carried her to the bathroom, then into her special chair at the nursing home. In fact, yes, I transform every flower, blade of green grass, sapling, yes, sapling, into a single spoon, silver. Here we go, polished with antique cloth and placed deliberately onto the headstone. Yes, there you are, peace.
Yeah, I remember I really began my writing career myself when my parents got very old. And I found I just had to write. And I'm assuming that you're going through that experience now.
It seems so, yes. It's something I've just been grappling with, I think, naturally over the years. And I found it's definitely providing a lot of, I don't know if inspiration is the right word, but certainly food for thought when I sit down to write.
Yeah. Now, you completed an MFA at Southern Connecticut State University. What was impelling you to go for that extra degree?
Oh, that's a great question and a complicated question. But I think one of the things that really drew me to the MFA was that, and this might be a reason perhaps in the early stages of deciding if I wanted to go or not, was just really thinking of myself as a writer and wanting to give myself a chance and taking that seriously. And I had already been in school, and there, I had a professor during my undergrad who had gotten his MFA, also a PhD, and was the poetry professor there. And he was encouraging me as well. And so I had some mentorship and decided to apply. And I'm glad that I did. It was a great experience. And it was so much more than just the workshops as well, which were very valuable. But it's a full degree with master's level classes, linguistics, education, et cetera. So it's very good education.
It sounds wonderful. Do you think you're going to pursue more academic degrees, or you're not sure?
I've been considering not necessarily pursuing a PhD in creative writing, but perhaps in other areas. I have very diverse interests. So I haven't entirely decided yet, but I think of myself as a lifelong learner. And if I were to continue learning in a formal setting, you know, I'd feel very, very good about that and be able to advance my career. So we'll see.
All right. Well, let's share some more of your work, please.
Okay, so this next poem, so I do write a lot about using religious themes sometimes, and then also I noticed during the pandemic that there was a lot of new poetry coming out with new themes, and a lot of poems and fiction about, you know, loneliness and isolation and things like that. So I wondered if this came through with that as well. But this was mostly a poem based on a painting by Salvador Dali. Mm-hmm. And so the title is The View from Heaven, and it's a self-portrait as Christ of St. John of the Cross by Salvador Dali. My fingers flex and caw like a raven's bones. Without flight, my own shadow keeps me company as John, Matthew, Luke, and Mark take our old boat out on the lake. I'm yellow against brown wood, their cloud puffs blue sky. Mountains of nights with friends, luscious green, rowing the boat to shore, hallelujah. If only I could walk on water again. If only John could see me now. It'd be like that day he teased, you'll never make it back to the boat. You'll be stuck out there forever. If only he knew that red wine, my swaggering sea strides, our hearty laughs were personal miracles just for us friends. If only they all knew this is what we've sacrificed. These days, I feel like the peasant children I used to preach about on the Mount, the ones from the cursed valley around Old Jerusalem, where wicked souls sacrificed their children into the dark. It was called Gehenna, I told them, the worst separation from those we love at the hand of a parent. Gehenna, from the same root word as hell.
That was a very rich image. I think that's why I keep pursuing you to have you on this program, because those images are just really nice. Share some more if you would.
Sure, and thank you for that feedback. And that poem, I don't have a lot of we'll say ekphrastic poems, where a poem is based on other art like paintings, but that's one of a few of them. So I'm happy to share that one. This next poem is called Daughter. Today, I learn her boyfriend's church is covered with saran wrap. The edges of their world bunched at the poles, where barely enough care to lift their hands. A congregation concealed in stillness. Sure, some folks squirm, but even as the planet tips upside down, she tells me they can't slide around like standing metro passengers at an unexpected stop. No, she's secluded in this ice age of plastic, with women not allowed to do this or that. It breaks me, catching me with no right words as she slips under with him into the cold. I wait till dark, rise up and up till the atmosphere pops like pink bazooka bubblegum, and poke a few holes so she can breathe with a pin. Lungs aren't meant for synthetic polymers, but some.
I would comment on that poem, but I'm afraid we might get into political and religious ideologies that I don't want to discuss. Keep going, please.
Sure. So, like I mentioned earlier, a lot of my poems will touch on religious themes, but also family, and many poems explore both. However, I do have a lot of poems as well where I explore just from the family side of things and family connections. So this next poem is called The Hunting Truck. At 13, I finally wanted to get mom a gift she would love. So I spent my allowance on an ornamental wall fixture, an orange face on a sun that smiles and sings oldies when you push the round little button on its nose. This is music she grew up listening to in a time before Vietnam. It's Now or Never on the radio in her mom's hunting truck. Going over bumps in the road, no seat belts, so fast, their heads hit the top and both throw out hilarious laughter in a way I have never seen.
You're talking about my generation. I neglected to ask you how old you are.
Sure, I'm 33.
Yeah, you could be one of my children. And I remember those cars with no seatbelt.
Yeah, yep. My mom has a lot of stories about that. She's 70, and when she was growing up, I guess, these were some of her most fond memories that she's talked to me about, just being in the car and finding those nice parts in the road where, you know, mom can drive over them and they all go, woo! It just sounds great, like a great time, you know?
yeah, it was. Yep. I'll just throw in this little story. When I was born in 1949, so well after World War II was done, but it took me a long time to recognize that we were in farming country, that the vehicle that we drove around the farm was called a weapons carrier because it carried weapons during the war. And I had no clue, you know, as a kid. You're just driving this thing and you have no clue. You just know it as the weapons carrier. Okay, go get the weapons carrier. So share some more if you would.
Sure, I have one more poem that I had prepared to read for today. It's called Fireflies. Horseshoe, it's a ringer. There's always too much time scooped out between seeing the family. 4th of July, a nephew nearly my age sparks a marshmallow on the cinder block fire pit as we laugh over Yingling and grandma's macaroni salad. Oh, how she would drive the girls in her hunting truck too fast on those Allegheny roads. No guardrails, up, down, no seatbelts. And her backyard glider summer sleeps, cradled in a blanket of fireflies. disappearing, reappearing, disappearing, like our memories.
I'm curious now, how long would you say you've been writing?
I think I wrote my first poem when I was about 10. And then as I got older, I continued just being interested in creative writing classes in high school and kept writing into college after that.
That's fantastic. Do you have a writer's group that you routinely interact with?
So I have my my colleagues who are all writers, where I help to edit an online magazine. But as far as having a current workshop group where we look at each other's writing, I guess I'm in between those at the moment. But those are very good to have, and I think important to get those other perspectives on your work. And I do have friends I share my work with and family, and I read my poems to my husband and stuff. But as far as having a group, I guess I'm in between that right now.
Yeah. So you have had in the past.
Yeah, through MFA, and then also different groups like you can find online and stuff like that. So
I found myself that I did not develop as a writer until I started doing face-to-face critiques. Because then I began to get a sense of what really worked, as opposed to trying online. Online, you know, a faceless person I never met, never knew, and never saw again would give me a feedback. And I did not grow from that, but I did grow from face-to-face contact.
Yeah, I can see that. I think there's that certain kind of maybe emotional presence-based feedback that you get from someone, just what it's like being in the room with them when you read your work. I think you get that, you know, doing readings. But as far as working on poems in progress, you can almost kind of tell when it lands. Like if it's a good ending, you kind of can feel it in the room right afterwards. You're like, oh, that worked.
It looks like we've got about 5 minutes left. So I'm really glad you succeeded in writing and stayed with it since you were what, 10 years old, you said? From my perspective, I didn't start, I began to write when I was a kid, but I didn't really get a lot of support for it. And I didn't trust myself to make much more than a couple of sentences until I was in my mid-20s. So when you can start your writing career and be at this level by the time you're, what, 33-ish, you know, you've got a great future ahead of you. Like I said, I'm pretty blown away with some of your stuff. It's just amazing. You don't have any other little lines there tucked away that you might drag out for us?
No, unfortunately, I think this was all that I had prepared to read for today. But I could, we could talk more about writing or my work in general or something like that. I'm sorry. I don't have anything else to share as far as additional poems to read.
Yeah. What advice would you give to someone who is struggling? Because I meet poets at all levels. Some people are just starting out and they're much older. Some of them are just starting out and they're young. But what advice would you give them? We've got about 3 minutes left, perhaps.
Oh, that's a good question. So someone who's struggling with writing.
Yeah.
Like maybe writer's block or something like that. Well, there's something in psychology called the default mode network, I think it's called. So it's just the activity in your brain where you're sort of at normal, we'll say, or default. And so a lot of times when people are on their phones too much or you don't have enough downtime, your brain doesn't really have enough time to just relax. And then in order for you to get distracted and have creative novel ideas, you kind of have to start from that state of like letting yourself just sit and look at a tree or go for a walk and don't be on your phone or just look around. So I guess maybe my advice would be to just try to get back to basics of just letting yourself have enough time to even allow yourself to become creative in the first place, because life gets busy.
Yeah, so you recommend unplugging. I find my best time for writing is my husband's still asleep in bed in the morning. I'm fresh. I've just had some nice dreams. I can begin to pull something together that I can be proud of. What time of day do you usually write?
I've been really productive with writing in the morning, and usually with my productivity in general, like having a lot of energy the first few hours. And then another time I'll write a lot is really late at night. So kind of either early in the morning or really late at night, depending if I'm doing the night owl thing or not that day, mm-hmm. which I think might be a writer thing. We all seem to be night owls. That's what I've noticed.
Well, my husband's the night owl. He writes as well. He's the night owl. And I have to do it early in the morning because I've never, even in college, I would not stay up past my bedtime.
That's good. Good for you.
And that default network or whatever it is, I forget what it is, the default mode in our brains. Yeah, it's very important to get out of that. It looks like we're coming down to 1 minute left. Thank you, Rebecca O Bern, for being my guest. I've really enjoyed talking to you. I'm going to remind the audience that Berks Bards has a first Thursday on Zoom. That's the first Thursday of every month at 6 p.m. And I encourage you to go and listen. I think we're doing open mics through January, February, and March as Berks Bards changes leadership. So I encourage you to take your poems there. It gives you an opportunity to try them out in front of an audience and get some feedback. It's a little softer than a critique group, which might say, hey, this isn't right. You need to adjust this. Whereas at Berks Bards, everybody will be very appreciative that you've got up and shared your work. So thank you so much. It's been a pleasure.
Thank you.
BCTV receives state arts funding support through a grant from the Pennsylvania Council on the Arts, a state agency, funded by the Commonwealth of Pennsylvania and the National Endowment for the Arts, a federal agency.